Please welcome back the chair of the Radio Television Digital News Association, Vince Duffy.
My job is to come out and try to quiet you down, so we'll see how that works. Oh, not too bad. All right, we're going to go on with the show right now. Our next presenter, please welcome ABC News radio correspondent Aaron Katursky.
You see where the drinks are at the ABC table. The more you drink, the faster this goes. So please, thanks very much for having me. It's a true pleasure to stand before you to present our next awards. Our category, News Documentaries, Arizona Public Media put birthright citizenship in the spotlight with their story of the legal battle being waged on undocumented parents and their U.S.-born children.
The De La Rosa's economic situation got worse when Gloria was denied a green card. She was the breadwinner of the family, cleaning hotel rooms and selling food on the side. The separation has made them stronger, even closer. The siblings wipe their own tears to be there for each other and save their moments of weakness for when they're alone. Next month, it will be 6 years since Gloria was denied a green card at that appointment in Juarez. And there are 4 more years to go before she can apply again.
Well, hopefully 4 years from now, my mom is back here.
Arizona Public Media was unable to join us, so we will accept on their behalf. Congratulations. Next, WDAY-TV examines the growing problem of sex trafficking in oil boom North Dakota. Oh, you're here?
Today, Renee Danielson helps Danielle begin the process of removing tattoos her sex trafficker made her wear.
They were brands. They were. A lot like, you know, you would brand a cow.
I experienced my first incident of being trafficked at 13 years old.
A dozen men from the oil patch charged with trafficking women for sex recently. Investigators combing through websites, setting up detailed stings in motels to catch the men behind the supply used to meet the demand.
Accepting for WDAY-TV is reporter Kevin Wallivant. Michigan Radio reported on shockingly unsafe drinking water in Flint, Michigan, how citizens are being affected, and what's being done about it.
The report showed lead levels at Leanne Walters' house were way, way worse than she thought. We're talking simply jaw-dropping numbers. Let me put it this way. If you have a glass of water and it has a lead level of 5,000 parts per billion, the EPA considers it hazardous waste. One sample from the Walters house had more than 13,000 parts per billion. The scary part is this report said there was reason to believe that the Walters could be a canary in the coal mine.
Accepting the award for Michigan Radio is reporter Lindsay Smith. In 1965, an American Navy commander's plane was shot down in North Vietnam, and he would become a prisoner of war in the infamous Hanoi Hilton. This story is from Alabama Public Radio, Public Television.
He was going crazy by the end of it. He said that he could see angels and demons in the bricks and in the globs of plaster. Rabbit, the interrogator, finally comes back in and says, Are you ready to cooperate? And Rabbit can't believe it, but Jeremiah Denton, after these three horrible days of no sleep and no food almost, says no.
Whatever the position of my government is, I support it fully.
What he also does is blink out the word torture in Morse code.
Accepting for Alabama Public Television producer Mark Fastison. The 20th anniversary of the assassination of Israel's prime minister, and although the case appeared open and shut, there are a number of conspiracy theories that still abound. This American Life brings us this story.
Rabin staged his own assassination in order to improve his popularity and the popularity of the peace process.
Yes, yes.
And then got into the car on his own.
On his own feet.
And then maybe in the car he had a stroke, you're saying?
This was the push and pull of the conversation. Some parts of his theory Hillel would deliver in the most emphatic tone you can imagine. About other parts, he would say, maybe, I don't know, I'm just asking questions. It's a prerogative of conspiracy theories not to have to answer questions, but just to raise them and keep raising them.
Accepting for This American Life, reporter Dan Efron. HBO film Citizen 4 explores the handling of classified documents with evidence of mass illegal invasions of privacy by the National Security Agency.
Disturbingly, the amount of U.S. communication ingested by NSA is still increasing. The truth is that the NSA has never in its history collected more than it does now.
Does the NSA routinely intercept American citizens' emails?
No.
Does the NSA intercept Americans' cell phone conversations?
No.
Google searches?
No.
HBO could not be here this evening, so we will accept on their behalf and congratulations. If you're charged with a crime, a jury of your peers will determine your innocence or your guilt. But who selects those jurors? Life of the Law took a closer look at this $400 million industry.
Do you have any strong religious beliefs?
I'm a Baptist. I believe in God.
Thank you.
We are obsessed with understanding juries, especially how they're selected.
Baptist.
You think he'll sympathize with fun?
Worries me.
Makes me nervous.
Today, finding a jury is another step, another battlefield in the courtroom drama.
Gentlemen, trials are too important to be left up to juries.
Accepting the award for Life of the Law, reporter Ashley Cleek. Next, Yahoo explores a dark chapter in America's political past when gays and lesbians were barred from working for the federal government and the FBI through its Sex Deviates program.
Homosexuality was considered such a horrible thing in that decade. If they discovered a gay person in government, could blackmail them into betraying state secrets.
We get J. Edgar Hoover's Sex Deviant Program memo of 1951. For us, it was an aha moment that we've got J. Edgar Hoover in our sights, and we're seeing him provide his brand of sick, obsessive focus on gay America.
Each supervisor will be held personally responsible to underline in green pencil the names of individuals who are alleged to be sex deviants.
Accepting the award for Yahoo, Chief Investigative Reporter and Correspondent Michael Isikoff. The Dead Unknown tells the story of the Jane and John Does and the thousands of families left in the dark about their loved ones' fates, a problem called the nation's silent mass disaster. This from the Center for Investigative Reporting.
Body is a daughter of somebody if the parents are still alive, or could be a mother, or could be a sister. And if there's a killer still out there, we'll do everything we can to bring them to justice.
Until we can identify these bodies, there's the criminal aspect of it is somebody's getting away with murder.
As humans, it's important for us to know the fate of our loved ones.
Accepting the award for the Center for Investigative Reporting is Editor-in-Chief Amy Pyle. Next, the awards for excellence in sports reporting. Middle school students in Mississippi learned about the struggle for civil rights as told through the story of black football player Willie Heidelberg. WMSI-FM reports.
It started out as a class project at Purvis Middle School.
We were looking for something to make it more meaningful to the kids.
Principal Frank Bunnell says they wanted students to learn more about someone in the local community who was involved in the struggle for civil rights. And that's when he read Willie Heidelberg's obituary.
Our quick pitch goes back to Heidelberg.
He was only 5'5", 143 pounds, but he had a big impact on college football in Mississippi. Go to a game these days, and it's hard to imagine a time when black athletes were not allowed to play at the bigger schools.
Accepting for WMSI-FM is News Director Randy Bell. One of the best swimmers in the nation trained in her small town's only indoor pool located in a hotel. KREM 2 News showcased the swimmer's unique training, and it was a challenge by making the hotel the central character in the story.
17-year-old Emma Shands puts in the work. Stretching her ability, she's become the top swim recruit in Washington State and one of the best in the nation. Her times are incredible. She's already qualified for the Olympic trials in 5 events. Imagine accomplishing that through thousands of grueling training hours in a remote logging town and a hotel pool. This Olympic hopeful has to negotiate around everything from the kid with the noodle.
Go play, go swim.
To a swim party of little girls.
Accepting for KREM-TV, anchor Jane McCarthy. WLRN introduces listeners to a Florida craze called foot volley, kind of a cross between soccer and volleyball. And the marquee attraction is called the Shark Attack.
Shark Attack!
These days, if you're sitting on a South Florida beach and someone shouts Shark Attack, it's probably got nothing to do with Jaws. Instead, it's got everything to do with feet. That is, a sport called foot volley. A blend of soccer and beach volleyball. In a shark attack, players spike the ball over the net using their feet. That means getting your toes 6 feet, 8 inches high in the air, slamming the ball back at your opponent, and then landing in the sand below without breaking something.
Accepting for WLRN is news director Taryn Shepherd. Next, a star athlete is sidelined by a rare spinal disease, and her community rallies around her. This story from WZZM-TV.
After two major back surgeries and a long recovery,
I'm gonna give up my team.
Big Ann.
Come on, Andy!
Back on the court.
Move your feet!
Her mom.
Rebound!
Back in the stands.
Oh, gosh.
Overflowing with emotion.
Box out, Annie!
Like stress.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Concern.
Oh, God. Don't fight for it, Anna. Not now. Not now.
And excitement.
Annie, get it, Annie!
Another rebound. When Anna Lee took her first shot in almost a year.
Oh, my God, Anna!
The result left mom. Speechless.
Accepting for WZZM-TV, reporter Brent Ashcroft. After losing family members in two separate plane crashes, a rising basketball star perseveres to achieve his dream. We get this story from ESPN.
A plane just crashed.
And all of a sudden, big boom.
8 years later.
Oh my gosh, it is unbelievable.
When you're millimeters away from death, you look at life through a different lens.
He is a walking miracle. He just went full force, go big or go home. Like Dad always said.
Austin Hatch has reached his destination. Secure in the belief that he has never been alone, that his family will always sustain him.
I love you.
I love you too.
Accepting for ESPN, reporter Chris Conley. Free Press Media slowed down and savored some of the best moments of the Vermont City Marathon and Relay. accepting for Free Press Media, visuals coach Ryan Mercer. Devastating ski crash, a life-altering diagnosis, the Denver Post profiles a courageous young girl with a fierce determination to regain control of her body.
Seeing the landing go by on anything is real scary. I just felt this like big whoosh, and my legs were like numb.
She currently has no movement in her trunk or lower body. To be completely honest, some of those nerves are probably gone for good.
That same competitiveness, I think, that got us here is also going to be what gets us out of here or out of this situation.
Yeah, it happened, but now can't really go back. Unless, like, they make a time machine, then you can go back, but they haven't yet.
Accepting for the Denver Post, video photojournalist Lindsay Pierce Martin. For the second overall excellence award presented to the Washington Post. The Post video team tackled some of the most important stories of the year: police accountability, the plague of Ebola, the rise in heroin use, all with spot-on reporting and in-depth analysis.
This is getting worse every day.
Law enforcement is under a microscope. Everything they're doing is being questioned.
I think that if body cameras are done right, with good policies in place, they have the real potential to serve as an effective oversight mechanism.
The devil killer strikes with Ebola.
Josephine Dolly's life was changed forever when the Ebola epidemic struck Liberia. Josephine lost her husband and all three of her children.
As my family died, sometimes I sit and look at them, put them into a plastic, zip the plastic, throw them away.
Accepting for the Washington Post, the director of video, Micah Gelman. Vince is back, so welcome back to Vince.
Please give a warm welcome to our next presenter, CBS News correspondent and anchor for CBSN, Elaine Keanu.
Excellence in Newscast is our next group of awards. Victoria at Noon is CFAX 1070's premier newscast, designed to provide a showcase for local news with additional updates on important national and international stories.
Victoria councilors debated a motion to have staff investigate how to increase shelter space in the city year-round, and that could include creating an area of garden shed-type structures for homeless campers.
Dignity Village, Opportunity Village, other places like that, they have the supports, they have the regulations, they have the codes of conduct. This is what we're talking about. We are not talking about this council saying, let's have a tent city.
The Prime Minister's idea of taking billions from the middle class to give it to the wealthiest few is atrocious. Which is it? Let them eat camembert or let them eat goose?
CFAX 1070 could not be here, so I'll accept the award on their behalf. WISC-TV covered the decision and the aftermath when the district attorney's office did not charge a Madison police officer for shooting and killing an unarmed 19-year-old.
No charges. A Madison police officer cleared of wrongdoing in the shooting death of Tony Robinson.
Now a community deeply shaken fights for change. Our live team coverage is throughout Madison.
No charges should be brought against Officer Kinney in the death of Tony Robinson Jr.
Demonstrators are kneeling in prayer right now and taking a time out to speak about Tony Robinson and their memory of him. Right now, it's a moment of silence as they are praying and stopped on West Stodey Street. They have not yet made it to the Capitol.
Accepting the award for WISC-TV is news anchor Susan Simon. Fans trudged through severe snowstorms while celebrating the Patriots' Super Bowl win. WBZ recapped the game's dramatic ending while giving listeners critical weather and traffic information.
Snow in Boston. Here we go again, right in the thick of it.
Very cold this morning, snow falling heavily at times. 1 to 2 inches an hour, total accumulation by the time it winds down this evening, 6 to 12 inches city, 12 to 18 inches immediately northwest.
And it's good!
Last-minute interception at the goal line saves Super Bowl 49 for the New England Patriots. And the question this morning was the Seahawks' decision to throw the ball rather than hand it to Marshawn Lynch, the worst play call ever.
So cool! So cool!
Oh, my God!
Go Pats!
Accepting for WBZ is morning news co-anchor Deb Lawler. A manhunt for a suspected murderer, a memorial to Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, and honor flights for veterans to the nation's capital are just some of the stories on KMBC's nightly newscast.
We're following breaking news tonight. Police still on the scene in Sedalia, involved in a manhunt for a dangerous murder suspect accused of killing the woman held captive in a box for months and her 17-year-old son. There's a new memorial for Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, a permanent plaque now where Brown was shot and killed by police last summer. It was installed this morning. Yesterday would have been Brown's 19th birthday. Our Matt Evans traveled with this group of heroes earlier this month. They were moved by each and every experience, from a police escort to seeing memorials for the first time. A privilege for all of us to share their emotional stories with you.
Accepting for KMBC-TV is news director Sherry Brown. CBS World News Roundup provided in-depth coverage of the deadly shootings at a Charleston church. Co-anchored by Scott Pelley in Charleston and Steve Kathan in New York, the broadcast took a comprehensive look at how the city was coping in the aftermath.
We're just outside the Emmanuel AME Church, where 9 members of a Bible study were gunned down Wednesday night. Now, flowers are in front of this historic black church, a memorial to the victims of what authorities are calling a hate crime. I can see 9 white ribbons tied to a black fence, one for each of the victims.
This is evil. To call it anything else is just not doing it justice.
Hundreds filled the pews at this community prayer service, where Second Presbyterian Church pastor Cress Darwin says shootings are a true test of faith and hope.
People do recover.
Accepting the award for CBS Radio News is correspondent Steve Kathan. In the wake of the Paris attacks, NBC Nightly News covered this complex breaking story with strong investigative, national security, foreign and political reporting, and exceptional storytelling skills.
Breaking news tonight from Paris as the terror attack ringleader is confirmed dead. Our exclusive interview with the masked SWAT commando who led the heroic raid on the concert hall, what he calls hell on earth. Hundreds of hostages cowered on the floor in fear, police facing down a ferocious assault by the attackers. Only a bullet-riddled shield between them. Also tonight, Richard Engel, inside the massive intelligence failure, the ringleader hiding in plain sight, right under their noses, with Europe's first female suicide bomber.
Accepting the award is NBC Nightly news anchor Lester Holt.
Get to talk. never give an anchor a mic. Thank you. But you know, before I accept this, I just want to say what great company this is to be in. I'm bullish on what we do. I'm proud of all of you, and it's great to be here. Nightly News has made a commitment to the big story. When this big story is happening, we want to be there. It was quite a mobilization to go to this one. We had just been in Paris 10 months earlier, covering the Charlie Hebdo attacks, but there was something about this one, 130 people killed, that really reminded us that it was a new day in not only France, but in Europe and even in this country. There was a certain collective sense of vulnerability with what happened there. And our goal is to anywhere we go is to not just go to anchor the newscast, but to tell the stories in all the ways we can, utilize all our tools and our experience, and that's what happened. But thank you so much for this award. I'm so proud of our nightly news team, and to watch that team swing into action when there is breaking news is simply breathtaking. Sometimes I just have to stand back and watch it all happen, and I'm just privileged and proud to be part of that team. Thank you very much. Now my fellow debate moderator.
First up in our features category is KMUW. A Wichita Police Department's outreach team is forging relationships with the city's homeless because, in their words, arresting your way out of homelessness doesn't work.
We head to the Wichita Greyhound bus station. The Finding a Way Home program has helped more than 100 people get off the streets by providing them with Greyhound bus tickets. Daryl came to the bus station hoping to get a ticket to California, where a relative has agreed to take him in.
Is it okay if I ask you what your mental illness is?
The program will pay for his ticket.
If they were to stay here because of their mental illness, they would become one of the chronic homeless out here. And they have somewhere to go, so it's important we get them there. Trying to arrest your way out of homelessness wasn't going to work, and it doesn't work.
Accepting the award for KMUW is news reporter Abigail Wilson. As Abigail is not here, I will accept this on her behalf. A woman's unconditional love was tested when two of her children revealed that they are transgender. WISC-TV followed this family's unique and difficult journey.
Avi, the oldest, says he knew at age 3 he was transgender, but didn't tell his mom until high school.
It was awful. Definitely made me never want to come back to Madison.
Avi moved to the East Coast.
I went back in the closet also.
And Skylar came out in high school.
I didn't know how to react. My upbringing made me to, this is not real.
Just as he shared his life online, he shared his goodbyes there too. His note posted to Tumblr after he had already ended his life.
He asked us as a parents to fight. Their pain is immeasurable.
Accepting the award for WISC-TV is anchor Michelle Lee. When a feisty 6-year-old was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, his doctor earned the family's trust in a way that few could. The story is from WBUR.
He really didn't talk a whole lot at first. I think he was just angry and afraid, but he loved practical jokes, and so he would put a whoopee cushion in the chair and then, of course, sit down and...
One morning, his breathing was really heavy. His nurse came in and she said, is there anybody you want me to call? And I said, I need to call Melody.
I truly believe that when you can't cure, you can always heal or try to heal simply by our presence.
Accepting the award is the producer of WBUR's Kind World, Erica Lance. ESPN profiled a gay lacrosse player who reached out to encourage and support gay youth while promoting equality. The Courage Game is a story of bravery and healing through the power of sports.
12-year-old Braden Lang loves lacrosse. Earlier this year, he shared with his friends that he is gay.
About as withdrawn as a kid can get. I'm not leaving his room. Crying himself to sleep almost every night.
Hey, Braden. My name is Andrew Goldstein, and I'm a lacrosse player like you. Your dad reached out to me to hear about a 12-year-old kid coming out. That was the coolest thing that I've ever heard of. It's a tough road. Not every day is easy, but it's all going to work out. It's all going to be good in the end.
Accepting the award for ESPN is reporter Greg Garber. Radio surprised a World War II aviator with a flight in his former airplane, the Mighty Mustang.
These men are aviation cadets. If you're 17, you can enlist in the Air Corps Reserve.
Our mission at that time was to, number one, bomb the hell out of everything.
So sorry we stopped recording so fast because Ralph literally just stood up and went for the door. He was ready. Cowden and his crew strapped him in the back seat, and they even had a special control stick installed so Ralph and the other veterans they give rides to could fly the Mustang once again. So, with the push of a throttle, Ralph was young again.
Accepting the award is the founder of WarbirdRadio.com, Matt Jolly. Laments, Mother Nature let up. Are they talking about extreme heat or brutal cold? Using natural sound and brisk interviews, WNBC gives us both sides of an indelible weather drama.
I'm done sweating, so I'm gonna hurry up and come. It's just too hot.
It's as if New York has a split personality.
Too cold out here.
The 90 degree weather is stifling.
I'll still take this.
But whatever you choose.
Nice hot coffee, iced tea.
The frozen fountain or the wet one. Don't get too comfortable out there on the boardwalk. Remember, the polar opposite is only a few months away.
Accepting for WNBC-TV is photographer-editor Michael Del Judas. ESPN's E60 tells the story of a young man whose mother was murdered at Charleston's Emmanuel AME Church. He shares his remarkable outlook of why, for him, love will always be stronger than hate.
The Mother Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in downtown Charleston. In 2012, when Chris was a sophomore, his mother became an ordained minister at the historically black church. Chris's mother, Sharonda Coleman Singleton, was killed. She was 45 years old. One of nine victims fatally shot in the church massacre. The day after his mother was murdered, Chris Singleton had a message for the city and the nation.
I just say love is always stronger than hate.
Accepting for ESPN is coordinating producer Ben Hauser. Government is still playing the spy game, but today the desire for total information control has become reliant on private companies to run the surveillance complex. This is from the Center for Investigative Reporting.
The government has the capacity to track virtually every American phone call.
5 billion cell phone location records a day.
PRISM program sweeping up vast amounts of internet everything. Emails, photos, chats.
If you haven't heard, our government is spying on us. And it seems to have become addicted to our data.
The National Security Agency is quietly building the largest spy center in the country.
Telegraph companies of yesteryear made their money by providing a service. Communication. Today, the companies we use to communicate with profit by learning as much as they can about us.
Accepting for the Center for Investigative Reporting is Editor-in-Chief Amy Pyle.
Thank you.
For 30 years, a shipwreck hunter has been looking for the Hydrus, which sunk during the Great Storm of 1913. He finally found it. The Detroit Free Press brings us the story.
Their lives hinged on those engines running. And if anything happened to stop that engine running, they were doomed.
You have 5 years!
And it even popped over on the other side. Look at that. Look at the size of that.
A week after an amazing discovery, we headed back out onto Lake Huron to dive into history for the first time on the Hydrus. They see history in front of them. All 436 feet of the Hydrus.
Accepting the award for the Detroit Free Press is video journalist Eric Seals. Overall Excellence Award goes to Minnesota Public Radio. In 2015, NPR News produced exposés, provided live coverage of breaking news, investigated key issues, and delivered in-depth, sound-rich stories on the most important topics of the day.
It's been nearly 3 weeks since police killed Jamar Clark in North Minneapolis under circumstances that still remain unclear. The incident has become another flashpoint in a national discussion over police use of force against black citizens.
Mahalim is one of at least five men who are assumed to have been killed ever since leaving the Twin Cities for ISIS. The FBI believes roughly 15 young people left Minnesota to join the group. So what set a young man from Apple Valley on a path to death with a terrorist organization in the Mideast?
This hour, it's the Climate Cast. It's our weekly focus on the science of climate change.
Accepting the award for Minnesota Public Radio is Deputy News Director Laura McCollum.
Please join me in welcoming back to the stage NBC Nightly News anchor Lester Holt.
Thank you again. Let's take a look at the very best in news series. New Hampshire Public Radio examined how children in poor families lose ground in everything from healthcare to education and how this shapes their chances for success.
One of the front lines of public health in New Hampshire is on the second floor of an elementary school in Claremont in a storage closet.
I'm starting to lose a tooth right here.
Oh, yeah, a wiggly tooth, and then you got another tooth coming in behind it.
Yeah.
Before I tell you why an oral hygienist is cleaning teeth in this closet, consider this little girl as a case study. Second grade, suspected cavities on at least five molars. So how big a deal is access to oral hygiene? And can it actually impact a child's prospects down the line?
Accepting for New Hampshire Public Radio is News Director Sarah Ashworth. Just to be clear, that wasn't Sarah, but I don't really know who he was. He just stopped by and grabbed the award. Should have asked for a ticket. WVUE-TV uncovered jaw-dropping and illegal spending found in a statewide retirement board's records.
If funds are public funds, they can't be used for alcohol.
In 2012, Russ charged a $2,900 meal at Ruth's Chris Steakhouse in Baton Rouge. That included $717 on beverages. The year before, the bill topped $3,000.
Almost $3,200 at Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. And the citizens of Louisiana are paying for this. This is crazy. The people that are putting into these retirement programs, they should be screaming livid, because that's money coming out of their pocket. It's also money coming out of a taxpayer's money.
Accepting the award for WVUE is anchor and chief investigative reporter Lee Zurich. Migrants pouring out of Honduras to escape brutal conditions find Mexico is cracking down on them before they can even reach the U.S. border. WLRN has the story.
Kayla was headed to Miami when authorities in southern Mexico booted him back. But just about his entire family lives in South Florida, and he says if he returns to his town north of Honduras's capital, Tegucigalpa, the violent gang that rules his neighborhood will either recruit him or...
Dos primos tuve que los mataron.
They already shot dead two of my cousins. That's what I'd be going back to.
That's the dark dilemma for too many kids in Central America's violent northern triangle, Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. Murder rates there are among the world's highest.
Accepting for WLRN is editorial director Alicia Zuckerman. Years after the bombing of the federal building in Oklahoma, KFOR-TV talked with survivors and heard some incredible stories.
Felt like some of me was going down with the building.
And part of her did. Her grief and anger became unbearable.
I got out of bed, I put all of my Xanax in my hand, and I got a glass of water. And just as I was taking my hand to my mouth, this voice asked me, "Are you sure this is what you want to do to the rest of your family?"
She wrote a scathing letter to the man convicted of murdering her grandsons, Terry Nichols.
And he answered my letter, and that's when he asked me to. He said, "For all the pain and suffering I've caused you and your family, please forgive me."
Accepting the award for KFOR-TV is anchor reporter Linda Cavanaugh. Humans are having a profound impact on our world, and nowhere is that more apparent than the rainforest. An NPR team ventured deep into the Amazon to witness and explain deforestation firsthand.
A lot of the people who do the dirty work of illegal logging are actually just the poorest of the poor. It's practically slave labor. They sleep out here in the elements. They're paid very little. Eliseo and his crew set fire to the camps to make sure they can't be used again. Smoke billows into the air. Suddenly, we're not alone. We've been warned that the illegal loggers have scouts watching their camps. We try and hide, but the rubber tappers, headed by Eliseo, charge after the biker, firing their weapons.
Accepting the award for NPR is producer Lauren Magaki. We'll be right back. The series from ABC News explored the undeniable power of a face-to-face encounter with a story about an incarcerated man, the prosecutor who put him in jail, and his attempts to make amends years later.
He was on his way to meet the innocent man he put on death row, this time to apologize in person. Just months after he got out, he was given a different kind of death sentence, stage 4 lung cancer.
30 years is a long time to be in Angola prison for a crime you did not do. And anger is not the emotion that comes to
anger? Oh, I'm upset, yes. But it's not my driving force.
Marty Stroud says he came here to say his piece, but did not expect anything in return.
It happened. It happened. And I'm sorry, I can't forgive you.
Accepting the award for ABC News is Nightline executive producer Roxana Sherwood. Texas Tribune brings us this news series on how Texas legislators' religious beliefs influence their lawmaking.
During the last legislative session, religion infused heated debates on gun control, gay marriage, and abortion, issues that consumed much of lawmakers' time. That's despite the fact that just 3% of Texans consider them the most important issues facing the state. Throughout the session, the God invoked by lawmakers was almost exclusively a Christian God.
The entire basis of Christianity is based on a single event in history, and that is the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
The way we get things done here is not by reading the Bible, it's by reading the rules of the floor of the House of Representatives.
Accepting the award for the Texas Tribune is multimedia reporter Alana Rocha. Either I can accept it on her behalf, or the guy that came by earlier could do it. But we will make sure this gets to the appropriate folks. In this series on lawlessness in the high seas, the New York Times reveals that crime and violence in international waters often goes unpunished.
Chief officer, you come with him. Pack your everything today, you go somewhere. They come for and say, look down. Say, this is your boat. I see the iron drums, tabletop wood with the rope. I'm going to go to the bus and I'm going to go to the boat in the machine. I mean, I'm going to be said, ah, that's how to fish in the finish.
Accepting the award for the New York Times is senior video journalist Alexandra Garcia. States consider allowing employers to completely opt out of workers' compensation plans. NPR and ProPublica took a look at how the concept has worked in Texas.
Rising 300 feet is a steel red and white communications tower. Billy Walker was here 3 years ago applying fresh paint more than halfway up. His wife, Crystal Malloy, was at home when she got the terrible news.
They said Billy fell. You know, he's on his way to the morgue.
Walker's employer was cited for safety violations and had opted out of state workers' comp. It had a workplace injury plan instead, which paid a death benefit of $250,000. If the company had workers' comp, Malloy and her daughter could have received as much as $1 million in lifetime payments.
Accepting for NPR and ProPublica is investigation correspondent Howard Berkus. Overall Excellence Award goes to the Center for Investigative Reporting, a nonprofit multi-platform news organization dedicated to engaging and empowering the public through investigative journalism and groundbreaking storytelling.
This is likely the most popular drug in America. What is it? Caffeine is in a lot of stuff, but most of it in our sodas and energy drinks is synthetic, meaning it's not from a natural source. How did this happen? And what else don't we know about this drug? The explosion of caffeinated products and how they're marketed makes you wonder, how much can we take before we crash?
Accepting for the Center for Investigative Reporting is Editor-in-Chief Amy Pyle. Next, we want to honor the finest and creative use of sound and video. It doesn't get any wackier that at an annual event held in a tiny Pennsylvania hamlet, Dushore, Pennsylvania is the proud host of the Outhouse Races. WITF reports.
I encounter my first outhouse of the night. It is bright yellow. It's got these green letters that read Steinies Heinies. So the perfect dump flushes out the police. Also racing tonight are the Divas on Duty. There's Team Nuts. After a lot of races, a lot of running, a lot of potty humor, and a lot of beer, actually, Steinies has taken third place. The second Super Septic Suckers have appropriately taken second, and Team Nuts wins first place.
I thought for sure someone named John was going to accept this one. Accepting the award for WITF is News Director Tim Lambert. ABC News takes us on a rare trip inside North Korea as the country marks the 70th anniversary of its Workers' Party with a giant military parade.
North Korea is a country with no freedom of expression, freedom of speech, and certainly no freedom of the press. So why invite us in the first place to cover their main event of the year? 70th anniversary celebration of North Korea's Workers' Party in Kim Il-sung Square.
Accepting the award is supervising producer, ABC News Digital, Ronnie Polidoro. Ronnie used to be one of ours. Proud of him. She said, he's with us now. I know. WYNC explored the pure joy of riding a modern elevator in one of the new World Trade Towers. The use of sound and acoustics transformed the anonymous elevator into something much, much more personal.
You might say that all of the sleek, speedy little elevators are the children of these slow, loud construction elevators that preceded them. Little more than cages on cables, they take us up to the unfinished, open boxes of air. Rooms yet unbuilt. No windows, no doors. Just
space.
It's completely open here. No walls. Just this orange netting. Come over to the edge. You look down, absolutely nothing keeping you from falling.
Accepting the award for WYNC is the host of The Takeaway, John Huckenberry. I will accept on John's behalf. KUSA-TV spent months with the people who call motels home in the Denver metro area. The story highlights the struggles of the working poor and the delicate balance between life and death in a tough neighborhood.
The motel life is very, very hard.
What's happening here is a tragedy.
The motel life is hopeless. It's a vicious cycle. It's becoming a norm. It is not normal.
The motel life encompasses life from inception to death and every human challenge that happens in between.
Accepting for KUSA-TV is photojournalist Corky Scholl. Cesar Chavez is widely known for the farm workers movement, but there's a rarely told part of that history. Filipinos, mostly men in their 60s, started the Delano Grape Strike. The story from KQED.
Just imagine over 1,500 old Filipino men in different fields, and they all walked out at the same time. I mean, how awesome is that?
That's where Cesar Chavez did his first fasting.
Farm workers are not agricultural implements. They are not beasts of burden.
People don't really realize just who in the heck walked in here, but I do. So it kind of tickles me, but we're part of a big history.
Accepting the award for KQED is reporter-producer Lisa Morehouse. WVUE's The Heart of Louisiana features a story about a Cajun bakery that has been rolling out some of the state's finest French bread since 1884.
The dough is mixed, run through a roller, cut into pieces, and hand-rolled into bread-sized portions. It's not until daybreak that the first trays of French bread are loaded into the oven. The warm smell of fresh bread spreads along Main Street in Generette. This morning ritual dates to 1884.
Accepting the award for WVUE is reporter and photographer Dave McNamara. During the Taliban's reign, no girls could enter Afghan classrooms, but thanks to this founder of a Kabul education center, today there are close to 8 million girls in school. This story is from the Ground Truth Project.
Talimo ki
هیچ کس حق نداره و هر جایی که باشه اگر او بخواهد که درس بخوانه با درس خواندن هیچ مشکل نیست. The day our school opened, the other side of Kabul, there was 100 girls killed. First day of opening of the school, because somebody threw hand grenades in the school. You just need one person to be crazy and not want these girls to go to school. You have to be scared, and you have to be careful, and you have to be protective of these girls.
Accepting the award for the Ground Truth Project is director of Ground Truth Films, Beth Murphy. Shot in black and white, this video pulsates with sound and graphics. While profiling Bieber, Diplo, and Skrillex, the New York Times. That wasn't right, was it? I don't get out much. The New York Times brings us the story behind the music of Where Are You Now?
I got this weird idea. I got this project with Skrillex. We should do a record with Bieber because, for one, no one would expect it.
I gave you attention when nobody else was paying. And then we'll go, all right, cut, let's get the next line.
We took a lot of his vocals and did different things to it, like added.
Where are you now?
People think that people have no talent if they make computer music. I think it's awesome. It just shows how young it still is and how relevant it's gonna be for a long time. It's like so rebellious in a lot of ways.
Accepting the award for the New York Times is senior editor Graham Roberts. Our fifth overall award for overall excellence goes to ABC News Radio. Vivid on-scene reporting brought listeners stories of terrorism in Paris, a deadly shooting in Charleston, refugees escaping to Europe, the legalizing of gay marriage, and a historic visit by the Pope.
We're getting word of at least two explosions near Stade de France during a France-Germany soccer game. We're also hearing of gunshots nearby, perhaps at a restaurant.
Police here are searching for a gunman who walked into a black church in the middle of a Bible study and shot and killed nine people.
The standoff on the border tonight erupted. Desperate refugees breaking through the gate, trying to force their way into Hungary.
The U.S. Supreme Court has just given same-sex couples the right to marry in all 50 states.
The red carpet has been rolled out and the stairs have been rolled up to the Alitalia plane waiting for Pope Francis to open the door and step out onto U.S. soil.
Accepting the award is Vice President and General Manager Steve Jones.
Hello, and thank you, Lester. Well, it's an honor for ABC News Radio to be recognized by our peers for the excellence of our work. And we're deeply appreciative of the support we receive every day under James Goldston's leadership and from all of our ABC colleagues, particularly those here tonight at those raucous tables 7 and 8. You know, despite the industry's direction towards consolidation in radio, 2 years ago, James Goldston supported ABC Radio in separating from our then distributor so that we could have complete control over our brand and our business. ABC does not own any radio stations, so to launch with 1,000 radio stations in January 2015 was a feat in and of itself. And through great support from ABC News and a dedication of our staff to providing our affiliates and listeners the most comprehensive news, sports, and entertainment programming, ABC News Radio now reaches more Americans than any other commercial radio news provider, and we are proudly serving over 1,500 radio stations, two of which are here tonight receiving Murrow Awards, including Hearst's WBAL Baltimore, right here at table number two, and Scripps KFDI Wichita. So congratulations to them. And thank you for this overall excellence award. And if there are any other tall recipients, this probably doesn't look all that good, but what are you gonna do?
Now we're going to go on to one of our newer and more popular categories, the Student Edward R. Murrow Awards. For overall excellence in audio, Noel Gaska from Radioactive Youth Radio Media presents Ivy.
Hiding behind, you know, what my dad was doing to me.
What Ivy's father was doing was sexually abusing her. Ivy went on to do something unimaginable, yet necessary for her freedom, testify against her father in court. Out of 500 students in her graduating class, Ivy was selected as one of the speakers for graduation.
I was really nervous. Nervous because I was just about to tell 6,000 people what happened to me.
Where is this girl now? She is standing before all of you. I am that girl.
Accepting the award is Radioactive Youth Media's Noel Gaska. For overall excellence in video, Kent State University's Vivian Feek brings us Making a Difference.
In the middle of darkness, with 106 homicides so far this year,
the guy was killed right across the street from me.
Michelle Schwartner calls Cleveland home. Now the retired businesswoman spends her days with the neighborhood kids, teaching them what she says are the little things.
Once you get it going, it's easy.
They're left alone a lot to just wing it.
Which is why she does anything and everything she can.
How is it?
Delicious. For the kids that come and go in her life.
I just feel like this is where I'm supposed to be in my life.
Accepting the award from my alma mater is Kent State University's Vivian Feek. Make all the students sit in the back. That's a long walk. Our third and final student award goes to Overall Excellence in Digital. And the winner is Wiped, Flashed, and Rekitted, the international black market of stolen cell phones.
In Brazil, the market demands expensive phones. It's like a status. If you pay expensive for an iPhone, you are a very important person. Lots of the phones that are sold in Brazilian markets, especially in downtown Rio, in downtown São Paulo, are stolen phones.
Mm-hmm. Accepting the award are three students from the University of California, Berkeley Graduate School of Journalism, Alexandra Garriton, Jake Nickel, and Chris Schott. Our next category honors the best in websites. KBIA.org is committed to innovation. Online features focus on state government, community storytelling, deep dive pieces with multimedia buildouts, and in-depth online reporting from the University of Missouri.
Welcome to KBIA's Business Beat, a show covering business, economics, and employment in mid-Missouri. I'm Sarah Shariari. Summer camps have a problem. More and more, college students are choosing professional internships over classic summer jobs.
Accepting the award for KBIA.org is news director Ryan Vermeulener. The online work of the St. Louis Public Radio Newsroom responded to the Ferguson story by offering points of reflection in multimedia projects. Deep data dives, creative uses of audio, and compelling commentary, and put it all together in a fluid and nuanced situation.
Today marks 2 years since an unarmed teenager, Michael Brown, was shot and killed by a police officer, sparking protests around the country. So we're launching a new project here at St. Louis Public Radio. We call it St. Louis Public Radio Listens, and we're visiting communities throughout the region to ask about the issues that matter most.
St. Louis Public Radio could not be here this evening, so I'll accept this on their behalf. And I'll just hold it. WGRZ.com goes beyond the headlines to showcase their investigative reports, long-form journalism, features, a weather page that includes interactive Doppler radar, and videos that highlight the regional history of Western New York.
You'll find Smithwoods tucked away in a corner of the tiny central New York village of Trumansburg, New York. At first glance, one might not think too much of it, but a hike through this serene forest reveals a long history.
Accepting for WGRZ.com is managing editor and anchor Michael Wooten. Just a sampling of the stories covered by NBC10.com. A deadly Amtrak train derailment, a project on Philly's homeless youth, the Pope's historic trip, and a fatal fire, which decimated a city block.
I didn't know that I was homeless. I didn't know that I fit the definition.
Today, we will turn a young person away from this shelter.
I just try to stay up as long as I can. Other than that, like, someone will tell me I could, like, sleep at their house or whatever.
Accepting the award for WCAU is the director of integrated media, Yoni Greenbaum.
Thank you.
Nobody wanted a selfie with Lester Holt. ABCNews.com took viewers from the streets of North Korea to the market stalls in Syria, giving unprecedented on-the-ground coverage of stories with global impact. In addition, an epic 40-hour live stream was packed with original programming.
Good morning, America! Happy 40th! And we're gonna do it like this. Let's go, kid!
I'm done?
You're gonna throw the take piece from your interview.
Yeah. I'm just doing this just to make them panic because they think I don't know what I'm doing.
Accepting for ABC News is managing editor Zaina O'Neill. Health News Florida holds state policymakers and practitioners accountable with independent reporting online and on public radio. They emphasize cost, quality, and healthcare access.
The popular description of Medicaid is that it's health insurance for the poor.
But in fact, it's not. It's health insurance for the so-called worthy poor, parents with dependent children, pregnant women, and the disabled.
Accepting the award for Health News Florida is reporter Wilson Sayer. The Center for Investigative Reporting's work includes video, text pieces, interactive apps, live events, and the nationally distributed radio show and podcast Reveal, which CIR co-produces with PRX.
Meow, 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 meow.
Americans have long been obsessed with cats, but for every cat in our homes, there's a stray one on the loose. At the local animal shelter, Monica Helgemo is overwhelmed.
This one here obviously is saying, pet me, pet me. This cat here, I see the ears go back. That's a feral cat.
Accepting the award for the Center for Investigative Reporting is Editor-in-Chief Amy Pyle. The Milwaukee Journal Sentinel takes a multimedia look at a 40-year-old cold case murder, from flaws in the police investigation to the lasting effect on the family and on the community.
While searching the home of the suspect, police found a disturbing scene.
One of them was a model of a fire station, police station, where the suspect had small photographs of all these missing dead children with little lights shining on the pictures of the kids.
Accepting for the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel is multimedia producer Katie O'Connell. With more than a million unique visitors a month, thestartribune.com is the top news destination in the Twin Cities market. A highlight last year was in-depth coverage of the alarming rise of deadly accidents on Midwest farms.
Why am I still here? Why ain't my little blonde hair, blue-eyed little boy, ain't he running around? Lost him on stupidity, stupid things. I mean, four-wheeler. I mean, it helped so much to do work around here. Having that skid loader, making it so much easier to clean pens and everything, comes with a hell of a risk.
The Star Tribune was unable to join us this evening, so I'll accept on their behalf as well. For our sixth overall Excellence Award winner, the focus is always on local and breaking news. CTV Vancouver's strong commitment to the digital platform and extended online video demonstrates a winning strategy of staying ahead of the curve in our rapidly changing industry.
These images captured right after a whale-watching boat began to sink. Now we're hearing stories of heroism and a community coming together in the wake of an unthinkable tragedy.
The 22-year-old has cancer. Doctors never expected her to live this long.
The last time we came into palliative care, roughly 3 months ago, they gave us days.
But Smalslet has a reason to keep fighting, the tiny unborn baby boy growing inside her.
A massive chemical fire triggers evacuations, shutting down the port of Metro Vancouver.
Also tonight, trying to steal your identity.
I'm really hating these guys.
The police bus that will leave you speechless.
Accepting the award is news director Les Staff. The adrenaline-induced breaking news is next. In Baltimore, a city on edge, the entire ABC News division quickly mobilized to provide truly exceptional breaking news coverage of the city of Baltimore as it erupted in chaos.
The riots breaking out on the same day Freddie Gray's family put their loved one to rest. The suspect who was arrested put in a police van in leg irons, no seatbelt, as that van answered several other calls, suffering a spinal cord injury and later dying while in police custody. In the middle of it all here, the man in the mask slicing the fire hose as firefighters tried to knock down the blaze. Tonight, the numbers, 247 arrests, 144 cars set on fire, and 15 buildings destroyed. This mother, after reportedly seeing her son, gets him, pulls him from the riots, and strikes him for his behavior.
Accepting for ABC News is senior national correspondent Jim Avila. KFDI was on the scene as severe thunderstorms produced a violent tornado. The station kept its listeners up to date and guided them through safety as the weather event unfolded.
There's a large funnel that's been touching down briefly. I'd say it's right at 2 miles west of Bentley.
101.3 KFDI FM and HD1, Wichita News Now.
Will Day in the 24-hour KFDI Weather Center. If you're just tuning in, we do have a tornado warning in effect for north central Sedgwick County, western Harvey County.
Half mile outside of Bentley, you say?
Yes, there's a tornado on the ground.
If you're in the path of this storm, we can't stress it enough, the safest place to be is below ground in a basement if you have one available too. If you're in a mobile home and you have a designated storm shelter, you need to move there now.
Accepting for KFDI FM is operations manager Justin Case. The New York Times examines the impact of the National Front, France's far-right political group, and how, fueled by fear, these movements are gaining momentum across the continent of Europe.
Horrific breaking news story tonight. Terror across Paris. It is a city under siege.
They are the National Front.
Poussez-vous.
France's far-right conservative party. Anti-immigrant, anti-EU, ultra-nationalist. And far-right parties like these are exerting influence across Europe. In the wake of the refugee crisis, debt showdowns, terrorism in the streets, far-right movements across Europe have been gaining momentum.
Accepting for the New York Times is senior video correspondent Adam Ellick. When terror struck in San Bernardino, California, ABC News Radio went live to capture the police search for an active shooter. The team was on the air from the first moments to the tense manhunt to the dramatic end.
Police in San Bernardino, California say they are dealing with an active shooter.
Multiple people down, up to 20 we've heard people down in this active shooter situation.
We are in pursuit of the suspect vehicle eastbound on San Bernardino Avenue from Richardson. We've got shots fired out the back window.
A black SUV, uncertain if this is the suspect. Tactical teams moving up the sidewalk, looking for positions of advantage right now.
Police scream toward this SUV. There's a rifle in the street. It looks like there may be a body in the street.
Accepting for ABC News Radio is correspondent Alex Stone. As riots ripped apart Baltimore in the wake of Freddie Gray's death, WJLA headed north to document what would prove to be a terrifying ordeal in a city under siege.
Anything these rioters can get their hands on, they are throwing. We're using a that window was just shattered there, that squad car. They're using riot gear.
The CVS over there was looted, and then it caught on fire. But in the meantime, prescription drugs were just out on the street. People were sorting through them.
Literally has the cash register in her hand.
Hundreds of police hold their ground as they are pelted with rocks and chunks of concrete. 15 officers are injured. The situation grows more violent.
Accepting the award for WJLA is Director of News Mitch Jacob. Knowing that much of the audience has lost power during a violent windstorm, WGEM-TV simulcast news and special reports on radio and on mobile devices to provide viewers real-time updates on emergency services.
The city of Quincy is in a state of emergency tonight. That after a severe storm slammed the tri-states. Power lines, trees, and traffic lights all down, buildings blown apart, and much of the city is in the dark tonight.
This tree is gigantic, and it is on residents Kelsey Jorsted and Jeremy Platt's home.
Yes, that was it. That was the sound everyone was hearing as that storm rolled through. This taken from downtown Quincy. At ground level, we had that storm rolling through the area, pushing down wind, 60, 70 mile an hour wind gusts.
Accepting the award for WGEM-TV is news director Chad Mahoney.
We'll be right back.
WBBM brought listeners the best of spot news coverage in the case of a police officer charged with shooting a Chicago teen. Complete with dash cam video, hastily called news conferences, and also spontaneous demonstrations.
A judge says he won't set bond for a Chicago police officer until he sees the dash cam video of the officer shooting a teenager, that officer now charged with first-degree murder.
Officer Van Dyke shot Laquan McDonald 16 times in a matter of 13 seconds. Perhaps most shocking, according to testimony from Van Dyke's partner, was that after unloading his 9mm semi-automatic, he paused to reload. The partner then told him to hold his fire as McDonald lay on the street.
Some angry people protesting peacefully on State Street.
We are here!
We are here!
United!
United!
Accepting the award for WBBM is Director of News and Programming, Ron Gleason. Now, please join me in welcoming our final presenter this evening, co-anchor of ABC News Nightline, Byron Pitts.
Good evening, everyone. Home stretch. We now go to excellence and continuing coverage. WXIA, WATL TV found that 911 can't always locate a cell phone during emergencies. Why? Because that technology was created two decades ago, long before the advent of the modern smartphone.
911, what is the address of your emergency?
I'm in the car
and
I'm late.
Where?
I'm moving the air very quickly.
Give me the address one more time. It's not working.
19 minutes ticked away before rescuers found the pond, and 29 minutes after Chanel called 911, Cherokee County firefighters pulled her unconscious from the sunken SUV. They found her too late to save her life. Cell phones have allowed us to reach 911 from anywhere, but rescuers can't reach us if they can't find us.
Accepting the award for WXIA 11 Alive is Chief Investigative Reporter Brendan Keefe. Cat-like reflexes there? That's impressive. Hawaii Public Radio reported on protest over construction of a 30-meter telescope on a mountaintop considered sacred by Native Hawaiians.
In Hawaii, a battle over the future of a mountaintop. Native Hawaiians say it's sacred ground. Astronomers say it's the best place in the world to build a massive 18-story telescope.
On an overcast morning, barefoot men and women dance hula 9,200 feet above sea level to a song honoring Mauna Kea, the mountain under their feet. Hundreds of protesters who have camped out on Mauna Kea for weeks watch the hula in silence. A gust of wind ruffles an upside-down Hawaiian flag, a sign used to show the state is in distress.
Accepting the award for Hawaii Public Radio is reporter Molly Solomon. WBAL's news team provided listeners with up-to-the-minute coverage of the Freddie Gray story, from the protest, unrest, and court case that captivated Baltimore and the nation.
Who are we here for?
Freddie Gray!
I do not understand how these police
police officers can kill us, kill our brother, and still get paid.
The president of the Fraternal Order of Police, Gene Ryan, compared the protesters to a lynch mob. When asked about that statement, he said,
Maybe I should reword that. I don't want it to turn into a lynch mob.
It's unfortunate, man, that these kids are really out here and they really think that this is a cause. Like, they really think they're doing this for Freddie, but they're really not. You really just spitting on his grave. Come on now. He would not stand for this.
Accepting the award for WBAL is news director Mallory Pinkard. That was Scott Mescal. Congratulations to the station. Addicts in Puerto Rico were being sent in droves to treatment centers in Chicago, which turned out to be nothing more than flop houses. WBEZ and This American Life wanted to find out why.
They were addicted to heroin, and they ended up in Chicago because someone in Puerto Rico drove them to the airport and put them on a plane with a one-way ticket to Chicago.
Make sure those are your documents.
But his ID was not there.
Dice que no está el ID.
In our reporting, this issue of the IDs kept coming up over and over. The people running these treatment programs would tell addicts to hand over their papers for safekeeping, but frequently, they never gave those papers back. A Puerto Rican identity complete with birth certificate, social security card, and state ID can go for thousands of dollars on the black market.
Accepting for WBEZ is reporter Odette Youssef. Died in the Chatham County Jail, WSAV led an effort to uncover what happened to the inmate and the underlying conditions which led to his death.
This is Frederick Burke. He was fired Friday for his still unknown role in Ajibade's death. He would be suspended without pay for this, opening the cell door without notifying a supervisor. And it gets violent. Then coming in to assist Deputy Mark Capers, who you can see delivers a blow with his knee to Corbett's head. That move would get him fired a month later.
Four deaths in less than a year.
And now a grand jury will consider criminal indictments against Chatham County Sheriff's deputies for the death of Matthew Ajibade in the Chatham County Detention Center.
WSAV-TV could not be with us this evening, so I'll accept this on their behalf. The NBC Nightly News team went well beyond the rioting that followed the death of Freddie Gray, reporting on the underlying issues, racial, economic, and social, of a city long in decline.
Something tapped this. Something was simmering here.
It's been simmering, Lester, for 40 or 50 years, really since 1968.
African-American men are vanishing from daily life in places like West Baltimore because of premature deaths and soaring incarceration rates. Andre Jolly is himself a convicted felon and recovering substance abuser.
I have an 8-year-old son and I have a 7-year-old son. And what I'm trying to do right now is be in their lives, be a father. And I think that's a big part of the problem. A lot of the fathers here are either incarcerated or dead.
Accepting the award for NBC News is NBC Nightly News anchor Lester Holt. We'll be right back. The difficulty of connecting unidentified bodies, or John Doe or Jane Doe, with their families leaves many in the dark about their loved one's fate. The Center for Investigative Reporting brings us the story of one cold case.
June 1st, 1969, in Harlan County, Kentucky, on Little Shepherd Trail, the body of a young woman was discovered by a man who was picking flowers for his wife. She had been stabbed in the chest multiple times, no clothing on her. She had nobody fighting for her. She could not speak for herself, and no one was speaking for her. I wanted people to remember her, and she deserved a voice.
Accepting the award for the Center for Investigative Reporting is Editor-in-Chief Amy Pyle. Louisiana's plan for sediment diversion is designed to restore the wetlands post-Hurricane Katrina, but it's being met with some resistance. This from the Washington Post.
Shrimp are saltwater species, and when you start putting this fresh water in the sanctuaries and estuaries where they grow, then you're talking about serious issues, because then the saltwater species is not going to come into the freshwater because they can't tolerate it. So we're going to have big problems around here. You start digging diversions. Look, we rely on shrimp a lot. We catch 30 million pounds of shrimp a year here. We just can't even think about having fresh water going back there like they're talking about. We'd much rather see them come in with dredges, pump. Diversions may work, but it takes 20 years to work.
Accepting the award for the Washington Post is video reporter Whitney Shetty. Our 7th Overall Excellence Award goes to WISC-TV, known as Wisconsin's own, the legacy station in Madison. WISC and Channel3000.com work in tandem to be one of the strongest CBS affiliates and local news websites in the country.
What do we want?
Justice!
What do we want it now?
Describe what the crowd is like out there.
A lot of emotion.
Madison's Oscar Mayer plant will be closing its doors.
The Madison facility is going to take the biggest hit.
It's kind of hard to take in.
But the vote on this right to work bill was what caused the ruckus earlier this evening.
Sometimes I just want to knock on God's door and be like, we're trying everything. Please help us.
To be champions, we got to play like champions.
Welcome back live to Indianapolis. Well, Wisconsin will face the number one team in the country.
We're so honored to be the sponsor for the 18th year.
Accepting for WISC-TV is news director Colin Benedict. Our next category is for outstanding coverage in hard news. WITF tells the heartbreaking story of one family's struggle and eventual loss to heroin addiction.
Anthony and his drug use had broken up his mother's marriage, caused unending stress, and then he upended all that his mother thought she knew.
Heroin never crossed my mind. I became hopeless. I think
especially once he started the heroin, but even before that, I prepared myself that he was going to either die from a drug overdose or be killed by a drug dealer. So I just stood there and looked at him for a little while. I remember shaking him and realizing that he was cold.
She blew out the candle, and she says time stood still.
Accepting for WITF is Transforming Health reporter Ben Allen. WBBH-TV investigated how powerful antibiotics are being prescribed for common symptoms and causing devastating lifelong consequences.
It's pretty much devastated our lives.
In 2011, Jamie Laura was prescribed Levaquin and Cipro for a simple stomach infection. For 2 weeks, she took the antibiotics known as fluoroquinolones. She says that's all it took.
This has affected every part of my body.
We were hesitant to show you this home video of Jamie, but she agreed, saying it's the only way people can see what she says the drugs have done to her body.
How overprescribed are fluoroquinolones?
Oh, they're dramatically overprescribed.
Accepting for WBBH-TV is Chief Investigative Reporter Jim Spiewak. The toll that November night in Paris was devastating. ABC News Radio's coverage wove together stories from the attack, the sound from the terrible night, capturing a poignant picture of all that was lost.
The first sign of attack came outside Stade de France, the packed soccer stadium on the northern edge of Paris, where France and Germany were playing. Denied entry, the terrorist detonated a suicide vest. A passport was found near the body. It's believed he entered Europe by posing as a Syrian refugee, traveling from Greece and Serbia before entering this country. After a second suicide blast, President François Hollande, who was watching the match, was rushed from the stadium. A third suicide bomber then detonated his vest.
Accepting the award for ABC News Radio is correspondent Alex Stone. When an inmate dies in prison from a simple asthma attack, WFAA spoke to witnesses who said guards did nothing to help.
Garland's breathing got progressively worse, and by 10:35 that night, according to his autopsy, advanced cardiac life support measures were initiated on Garland. He was transferred to a local hospital where he was pronounced dead.
He was denied medical treatment.
Curtis looked at me and he said, "Help me," three times.
All of them alleging Curtis Garland Jr. died a horrible death spanning the course of 6 hours.
But I did not know that they made him so. You see, they made him so, and they didn't have to. They didn't have to do that.
Accepting for WFAA-TV is investigative reporter Brett Shipp. CBS News' Laura Logan reported from northern Iraq, where ISIS has forced hundreds of thousands of Christians to flee from towns and villages they've lived in for nearly 2,000 years.
For the first time in nearly 2,000 years, there are no Christians left inside Mosul.
They take everything from us, but they cannot to take the God from our hearts.
One of about 10,000 Christians who fled the city. We found him living as a refugee in the Kurdish capital, Erbil. He said ISIS fighters were already inside Mosul when he escaped.
From the beginning of Christianity, this is the first time we cannot to pray in our churches.
Accepting the award for CBS News is producer Max McClellan. WAMU explored the effects of super PACs going local and how contractors are benefiting from their ties to local governments.
Public records show that you donated $10,000 to the mayor's quote-unquote fresh PAC. Is that correct? You gave $10,000?
That is correct.
Yes. And you are doing business with the city at the same time.
Local PACs aren't being funded by rich donors with an ideological bent. At the local level, it's about everyday city business.
You know, contracts, developments, grants, licenses. There's just so many ways in which local governments just hand out benefits.
Accepting the award for WAMU is senior reporter Patrick Madden. This is a haunting look at a girls' school that Vukovic visited outside of Syria. The school has been repeatedly bombed by the Assad regime, but refuses to close. Accepting is senior producer Judith Dubin. Happy to accept this on their behalf. Thank you. More than 40 mothers in central Washington have lost babies to a rare and deadly birth defect since 2010. But the cause remains unknown. The Seattle Times asked why health officials haven't done more to find answers.
Almost all the infants that we have died of anencephaly.
She was missing her head bone, and she was missing part of her brain.
Unfortunately, it's a condition that's what we call incompatible with life. The baby is unable to survive after birth.
I would like for them to actually take the time and find out what's going on. More people need to know.
Accepting for the Seattle Times is video editor Lauren Frome. Now for our eighth and final overall excellence award. ABC News was at the forefront of the biggest events, issues, and cultural touchstones of 2015, with exclusive or original storytelling that drove national conversations on politics, civil rights, race, justice, and religion.
Everybody has stuff in their life that they have to deal with. You know, what are we going to give him? And God looks down and chuckles a little bit and goes, you know, hey, let's give him the soul of a female and let's see how he deals with that.
In the video, Scott is clearly running away from the officer with his back turned.
That wasn't an animal that he killed. He was my son.
We have a president that doesn't have a clue. We don't know what's happening. We need toughness and smartness, and we have to do it quickly.
It's just after 10 p.m. here, more than 80 hours since the earthquake. And after an incredible all-day effort, this team has brought this young man out of this building, and he is alive.
Accepting the award is my friend and our leader, President of ABC News, James Goldstein. Thank you. So I flew back from St. Louis this morning. It's been an extraordinary few days in the news. We've been buffeted by storms, the real ones and the political ones. And tonight, as Edward R. Murrow looks down on us, I just wanted to offer two tributes tonight. First, to all the radio and television and digital reporters who put their safety on the line so that so many others could be safe in the storm zone over the last few days. An incredible job. And secondly, to Anne Martha Radatz, to Anderson Cooper, to our host tonight, Lester Holt, and Elaine Quijano, who for all, I think, reminded us at a time when we need it of all of the values that Edward R. Murrow taught us. This is the third time in a row that ABC News has won the award for overall excellence for television and radio. Couldn't be prouder of the team. Many of them are here tonight. Congratulations, all of you, and to the whole team. And thank you very much. We're going to come back and try to win it again next year. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, that wraps it up for the 2016 Edward R. Murrow Awards Gala. We'd like to give a special thanks to our sponsors. Our diamond sponsors tonight were ABC News and Tegna. Our platinum sponsors, ESPN and Hearst. Our gold sponsors, CNN News Source, Yahoo News, Raycom Media, and NBC News. Our silver sponsors, API, CBS News, The Washington Post, and the Associated Press. Our friend sponsor, the Ground Truth Project. The cocktail reception sponsor, Stephen Arnold Music, and the Center for Audit Equality. Thank you, everybody, for joining us tonight. We hope you had a great time. And congratulations again to all of our winners. I hope to see all of you in Washington, D.C. on March 14th for our First Amendment Awards dinner. Enjoy the rest of your night in New York. Good night.